Today we begin a sequence of talks about the diversity of life. These will be divided into separate topics. First, symbiosis and the evolution of organismal complexity, where we'll look at the evolution of the eukaryotes and how these gave rise to the fungi, the animals, and plants. Next lecture, we'll focus on themes that we covered earlier in the course about convergence and homology when we look at the diversification of the animals. Following that, we'll look at evolutionary innovations. So we'll be looking at complexity in a complex world. And this will be a place where we'll look at the trajectory of vertebrate evolution and the origins of our own species. After that, we'll focus specifically on humans. And I want to discuss various aspects of human evolution and human sociality. To begin with, symbiosis and the evolution of organismal complexity. The struggle for survival usually implies competition. If you're faster than the other guy, you may outrun a predator. If you're stronger, you may be able to gain valuable resources. If you're sexier, you may be able to get more mates. But the history of life includes many enduring examples of cooperation. This is essential for understanding the origins of the eukaryotic cell, for the origins of multicellularity, and these all revolve around the concept of symbiosis. Now, mutualism is where you have several different organisms that gain immediate benefits from their direct interaction with each other. And mutualism includes symbiosis. And this is where two different species live together in direct physical contact. They're touching each other. And endosymbiosis is where one species actually lives inside the cells of another. So we'll look at endosymbiosis and symbiosis to understand the origins of complex multicellular organisms. Now, we just got to bacteria in our lecture on the origins of life. We went from nothing to a living organism that can divide and reproduce. And these were bacteria. Now, these are very simple cells. They contain one chromosome, a circular chromosome, with little smaller sections of DNA inside them called plasmids. But otherwise, they're pretty simple. Just a bit of cytoplasm in there to take charge of metabolism. But when we get to the eukaryotes, these are far more complicated individual cells. Animal cells still have the DNA familiar from the bacteria in its nucleus, and this is where we have all of our chromosomes. But inside the animal cell, we also have these other organelles called mitochondria. And plants have even more complicated cells. They again have the nucleus with their chromosomes in there. That's where all the Mendelian genetics of Mendel would take place. There's also the mitochondria, these red things, but they also have these green jobs called chloroplasts. Now, these organelles, the mitochondria and the chloroplasts, are only transmitted in the cytoplasm. So we saw that on the lecture on selfish genetic elements. These are passed on in the eggs or the ovule, not in the sperm or the pollen. So that's the only way we've discussed it so far. But I want to go into detail more about what they do and where they came from. The mitochondrion here, which is cut away to look vaguely like a bedroom slipper, is actually a single cell that has sites of all kinds of metabolic activity. So it's the primary site in the whole cell for metabolism. So this is turning food into an energy that the cell can use to run its own engines. The mitochondria is aerobic. It likes oxygen. The processes that it's involved with for producing this energy relies on oxygen in some way. The mitochondria contains its own DNA. And I mentioned that before, that you could have selfish genetic mitochondria who might want to distort the sex ratio in order to pass on their genes in the female line. But now we want to really look at the DNA of the mitochondria itself. Forgetting about that occasional sort of outlaw behavior, what does the mitochondria usually do? It has its own DNA. It has a circular chromosome. And it reproduces by binary fission. So these actually reproduce inside the eukaryotic cell. And all this process of having its own DNA, a circular chromosome, reproduction by binary fission, it's not surprising then, perhaps, to realize that mitochondria are actually closely related to what were once free-living bacteria. In fact, the closest living relative of mitochondria in the eukaryotes is an alpha protobacteria. You don't need to know that fancy name. What I do want you to realize is it is actually related to the bacteria. Now, if we do phylogenetic analysis of the DNA that's found in the mitochondria of eukaryotic organisms, and we compare that to free-living bacteria, we find that all the bacteria in the world are over here, and here's all the mitochondria in the world over here, and animal mitochondria, fungal mitochondria, red algae, plant mitochondria, all of these show a common ancestor to a particular kind of bacteria that still lives freely in the environment, but at some stage, in fact, somehow infected certain cells and then began to reproduce entirely within the cells of eukaryotes. Now, an important prelude to this is to remember the history of life on Earth, that the Earth only formed about 4.5 billion years ago. The first truly recognized living cells, fossil bacteria we have, dating back to about 3.8 billion years ago. And then there were the cyanobacteria. The cyanobacteria were capable of photosynthesis, and their byproducts produce vast quantities of oxygen. And this changed the Earth's atmosphere forever, just over 2 billion years ago. So now the world is filled with oxygen. And it's after their appearance that we have the first eukaryotes. So we have first a high level of oxygen in the atmosphere, and then about 500 million years later, the first eukaryotes appear, and they're aerobic. They can take advantage of this oxygen in the atmosphere. So, back in the day, there were just bacteria, and there were two major lineages of bacteria. They're the Archaebacteria and the Eubacteria. And some of these Archaebacteria fed on Eubacteria. That's how they got their nutrients. But at some point, an Archaebacteria ingested but did not digest a Eubacteria. And the Eubacteria continued to live inside the Archaebacteria's cell and eventually became mitochondria. Now, a key background to this is that these Archaebacteria, they like living in volcanic vents. They like really extreme environments. They're the extremophiles we saw in the last lecture. They're anaerobic. So they don't thrive around oxygen. So therefore, their distribution was restricted to these volcanic areas. But once we had an aerobic world with oxygen all over the place, an Archaebacteria that engulfed but did not digest what became a mitochondria could now also be aerobic and now could venture forth into all the rest of the world. So here is the schematic for the origins of the eukaryotic cells. We have the prokaryotic ancestors, so all living things were a form of bacteria. There was eventually a division between the Archaebacteria, who liked those extreme environments, versus the Eubacteria that were aerobic. And at some point, an anaerobic archaea engulfed but did not digest an aerobic Eubacteria, and this gave rise to the eukaryotes. And subsequent to this, in the eukaryotic cells, there's two gene lines, the chromosomes of the host larger organism, and then the DNA of what was formerly bacteria and is now mitochondria, and they continue to reproduce separately.